It's my privilege this evening to introduce Dr. Lee Barnett to you. And Lee and I have developed a great relationship over the last few years. The best thing about Lee is Robin, his wife, and she is a wonderful lady. Lee has a lot of experience for his age. He's been our president about a year and a half, and he went to Belmont, Nashville, doctoral work, did a Doctor of Ministries degree, Liberty University, and through his career, he has taught 17 or 18 different types of college classes. He has a lot of experience with particularly not just teaching, but with academic administration, and we're grateful for him. I can say a lot about him. We have had times where he and I haven't agreed on a couple of things we were doing, and we formed the board, and they asked me to be the chairman of the board, him being the president. So we interface a lot, and we talk back and forth, and he's going to tell you about one little disagreement we had that lasted for a year. It was kind of interesting. One word I think describes him best, and that is faith. When we don't have all the answers, we don't have all the material ready for the accrediting group, or we don't have the money we need for the next few months, he's just trusting God and moving on. And I can tell you, what we are doing here is not for the faint of heart, but God has been showing up, as I shared with you this morning, with the accreditation. We have submitted 1,000 pages to the accrediting group, and we still have a couple of pretty big steps to take to make it, but God being our help, and you folks continuing to support and send us students and pray for us, we're going to make it, and it's going to be something special, because North Alabama needs Legacy Christian University. We need a place that teaches a biblical world view unapologetically, and where young people can come to a place and not have their faith destroyed. And so I am an advocate of what we're doing, and I pray that you will remember us when you pray. And we talked about the love offering this morning. Half of what we give to the love offering goes to Legacy. And Dr. Barnett's going to come now, and he's going to preach for a few moments, and then he's going to take a few minutes and talk about some of the steps we've taken recently and where Legacy is. So Dr. Barnett, you come.
All right, that was a little formal. We're at church, so it's just Lee. Okay? Now, if you're in one of my classes, that changes tomorrow night. We'll go back to that. But, you know, it's always a big deal to talk to your home church to me, because you know a lot about what's going on. And it's also always a challenge to come in for that one-shot sermon. Okay, you heard that from Terry, the noise down here. Because I teach my students, it's exegetical. You go a book at a time and do these things, and you get one shot. So to any of my students that are here, yes, I'm breaking many of my own rules tonight of what I've taught you on that. Because when I was asked to come in tonight, I was told two things. Preach the sermon and then talk about the school. Well, those are both 30, 45-minute shots, and I figured since this is my home church, I want you to still like me when we're done. So what we've done is broken this into two things tonight. And rather than come out of an exegetical study, I'm going to bring to you tonight Legacy's theme for this academic year. Each year, we pick a biblical theme, and we motivate our students on that for the year. And what we're trying to do is instill in them what they're going to do with their life. They spend a lot of time studying theology and Bible, and now that we've got other degrees, they study other things as well. But we want to make sure they understand the going and doing and the living side of that. So tonight I bring to you our theme, which is entitled Light It Up, and I'll be coming out of Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 through 16, and that'll be pretty familiar to most of you, but I'll let you turn there. Another aspect of picking that for tonight is I looked on the area that I'm studying during the week, which is where I normally preach from. And I'm in the book of Leviticus, and I'm in those chapters where you ought not have to tell people not to do those things. You know which chapters I'm talking about in there? And I decided that wasn't a good one shot for us tonight. So we'll keep it on a little different tack as we come in. But as we thought about what we wanted to focus on this year, this is our first year as a university at Legacy. We've been a Bible college up until now, and I'll talk more about that later. We've divided this up. I'm going to give you the message first, and then I'll talk about the school after we've had our time of response and invitation. So we'll break that up a little bit. We got to thinking, what do we want to do in this community? What do we want things to look like? Because there's a lot of schools out there. There's a lot of places doing things, but we want to be visible with our faith. And so we landed on this passage and this idea of lighting it up. So take a look with me here, starting in verse 14. Jesus is teaching. This is right on the heels of the Beatitudes, where he's saying, you're blessed if this is happening in your life because God's going to have activity. And you're blessed if this is going on and you can claim this activity and this attitude because God is working within that. And you're blessed if you're insulted and persecuted. And then he comes in and he calls us salt, and he comes into this part in verse 14. And he says, you, and he's talking to all the believers, are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your heavenly Father. Will you pray with me? Father, I ask that right now that you speak through your word. This isn't about promoting a school. It's not about anything that I have to say or doing, Father. We want to give you glory and honor from the things that you have said. And I pray that you would use this time to motivate us, to build us up, to challenge us, and to encourage us. And may every word that I speak point out the people here back to you, Father. May this be your time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So Jesus said light of the world, and I want to kind of break that down for a minute. When you think of light, what comes to mind? You don't have to answer out loud in a larger group, but we get some images that come to our head, right? You start thinking about light, you start thinking about flashlights, you start thinking about lanterns. I think about my next door neighbor's floodlight that he installed because his wife gets scared when he goes out of town, and if they're here tonight, I'm not being insulting, I'm just using an example. It is an airplane landing light that you can see from space. Okay, so those of you that work in space stuff, you can find my house easily by tracking that light. And it shines right on the back of the house. And so the first thing in my mind when I think about bright light, that's what I think of, okay, as that comes through. And it's a good thing. He wanted to make his wife feel secure, and he did that. And I bought heavier curtains. But that's what I think of when I think about light. But we have to look a little deeper at the concept and the feelings of it. Light tends to bring up images in our mind, things about safety and security, don't they? Because when we're kids, and some big kids, we're scared of the dark, aren't we? Because things go bump in the night. We think about warmth, visibility, guidance. Have you ever been anywhere where it was completely pitch black, like a cave? I spent the night in a cave one time, out camping with a group of guys with the scouts, and I was so surprised at how many big burly men kept flipping their flashlights on and off during the night, because we were all a little unnerved by just how dark it was. And the interesting thing is, just that little bit of light from a little flashlight lit up the whole area, because light does what to darkness? It dispels it. It sends it away. It comes over it. Now, this was especially important to pre-electricity, to people who lived before the electric light, because what happened at sundown? You couldn't see anymore. That's right. It got dark. So we talked about, you know, leaving the home fires burning, that type of thing. People could see and get home. And you couldn't do anything once it got dark. My grandmother used to tell me a story. And this will bother some of you, but that they would catch fireflies and rub them on their clothes so they could see each other outside in the dark. Okay, now I'm not promoting that. We're not hurting animals tonight or bugs or anything. But that was one of the things they had to do if they wanted to be able to go out in the dark, because we all have issues with that. And especially where there is no light, no source of electric light, the darkness always seemed unstoppable. So this really meant something to the people in this time period. So just like we need a source of light to shine out in those dark places. You and I know as believers, because we're in an evening service at Whitesburg, most of you folks here have this understanding. We need light to shine through the darkness in our own souls, but also in the culture around us, don't we? We need something to break through that layer of darkness, that thing that wants to distract us from seeing the truth. We know the truth. In this room, I would dare say most of us know that the truth of that is Jesus. But do they know? I think that's the question, isn't it? And that's the question Jesus is posing right here in this when he's telling them this. They don't see what the light is. They are blinded by darkness, the lost world, and they need us to be that representative of Christ. This is played out, this light of the world is played out through Jesus shining through us to them in the way that we live our lives. And unlike my flashlight, which often the batteries die while I'm outside in the dark, if you're like me, because I don't check the batteries enough, or the bulb in the hallway that tends to blow occasionally because weird wiring or static or whatever, you know what I'm talking about. This light that shines through us doesn't go out. Now, how visible it is varies, doesn't it? But it doesn't go out. And so Jesus carries it another step here. He says it can't even be overcome. Look at this. The second part of verse 14, Jesus compares us to a city on a hill. It can't be hidden. Now, remember, we don't think the same way they did. If you're walking through the desert and you see a city on a hill, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? The closest thing I can get in a visual analogy is A&M University up there. When you drive through that part of town, you can't miss the hill, can you? It's visible from every road in the area, the way it sits up. And what he is saying to us is that if we are in Christ and he is in us, we are obvious. Don't you get that for a second? A city on a hill can't be hidden, neither can the life of a believer, and neither can a church, and in our case, neither can a Christian university. So if we've embraced Jesus, and we've chosen to let the Holy Spirit be within us, we simply stand out. That's our natural state. Our calling is to be a little bit different, to seem a little bit strange. Easier for some of us than others to be strange, to shine in a dark world and to simply be obvious and attractive to those around us. That's what this is talking about, to be evident to the world that's looking in. So where does it start? We know that it starts with you and me, and it starts with Christians choosing to live a life that reflects the light of Jesus, but I think sometimes we're asking the wrong question. Most of my life I said, what can I do to make Jesus shine through me? As if he couldn't do it. You been there? Well, what has to happen? Do I have to pray harder? Do I have to wear a different kind of t-shirt? What do I have to do? Well, I think we're asking it from the wrong direction, because Jesus in this doesn't say you can be. What does he say? He says you are the light of the world. And you can't be hidden. So we're going to flip that around for a second and say that it's not that we have to work hard to shine, but it's just the opposite. A Christian in our natural state in Christ already shines. Think about that. Think about when you first gave your life to Christ, or somebody you knew recently that did. That excitement, that energy, it's there right now. We spend half our lives as believers trying to get that back, don't we? It's not that we can't shine, it's that we make choices that kind of blur it a little bit. Or we allow ourselves to get pushed back in society and by the people around us. It will shine, and it does shine. And Jesus' example supports this. Look in the next verse, in verse 15. He says, people don't light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Now, if we take that example for what Jesus says, it makes it clear we have to work hard to hide the light of Christ, not hard to let it shine. Now, that's completely backwards from where I came at it for years. If the natural state of the Holy Spirit is blazing through us, then I actually have to work at hiding it. Now, that puts me in a whole new place of accountability. because that makes me look at all the things that I know limit my witness and my effectiveness in life and say, it's not because I don't have enough Jesus, it's because I got too much of me. Would you agree with that? Jesus shows us very clearly the light is shining. But the degree that it shines, or the degree that it's visible to everybody else, is dependent on how I choose to behave and what my attitude might be like within this. I just simply have to decide to let him shine. If he says I already have everything I need for life and godliness, and if he says that righteousness has already been put on me, and I'm not going to be tempted with anything I can't handle because of the Spirit within me, then what on earth is causing me to put a bowl over the light? It's just my own decisions to fall back into an old way. And I think there's an encouragement in this, because that's a positive statement. That simply says to me, I don't have to work that hard for Jesus to do something. I just have to quit working against him. Or if you're from the areas I'm from, again him. Okay? We simply decide and make the decision that every time that we have the opportunity, we'll let Jesus shine. And let that light be so obvious that people can't miss it. That they're either offended by it and run away, or they're attracted to it and run to you. And both will happen, won't it? There's going to be opportunity for both sides of that coin to happen. But this is the calling of believers, is to be obvious with our faith. So we do work to become brighter. Jesus does the work, but we work to make sure it can be seen. And that kind of translates into the idea of being a more powerful witness or minister. And that goes back to our choice again to study the Word. To know what the Bible says about you and about me and how our lives are to be and the power that God gives us. To be approved because of our study. It helps us to be prepared to be ministers where we are. Now, I was a youth pastor for 20 years, senior pastor a few years in there, and I'm here to tell you that the most effective ministry in the world does not come from your pastors. Their job is to equip the rest of us. The ministry that happens out there where people get saved happens with just everyday folk. With those of us that go to work and we either sell things or we teach people things or we build things or whatever it might be or whatever engineers do. I don't understand that world. But when we go there and we go there in such a way that we let the light shine through us, that's where ministry happens. That is what we've been called to do. So it's not about professional ministry or clergy. I don't even like the words clergy and laity. It's about believers knowing how God has equipped them by understanding the gifts that Scripture says we have and understanding the hope that we have so that we can share it with people. That's what it means to be the light of the world. To put that out there before the people. It's not, well, let's go to church, because our calling is not about church stuff. Our calling is about bringing glory to God in a lost world. And we can't do that when all the lights huddle together in one corner. It's carrying it with us where we go, making our workplace a mission field. Being people of such integrity that it stands out. That goes a long way in our culture, doesn't it? It's about dealing with hardship in a way that shows that we're different because of Jesus. That we don't react the same way. That we choose not to panic, to lie, to cheat, steal, beg, or abuse people when our own life gets hard. And that when people ask us how or why we're able to behave that way, we're able to say it's because God is my provider, my shelter, my avenger, and my protector. He's my hope and He takes care of me. See, Peter tells us in his epistle that we should be ready at all times to give a reason for the hope that we have. And when we live in a world that is covered in darkness, which it is through sin and blindness to the gospel, it's that hope that gets people's attention. It's not arguing apologetics. It's not explaining theology. It's simply being able to say, yeah, I can get through this part of my life because I have hope. And because I recognize the reality of God, that's what makes a difference. That is how we shine our light. But again, we'll go back to this. It varies from day to day, doesn't it? Because some days I feel like a burned out bulb when it comes to light. You've been there? It might even be a fancy bulb. You look real good in the socket, but not doing much good. Not putting out any light. Sometimes that happens. In my younger years, I would have described myself as a faulty fluorescent bulb. You know, the one that it blinks off and on and the light runs back and forth and it makes that really obnoxious noise. I think that's who I was when I was younger. It was inconsistent. It was very inconsistent. Maybe that's where you are. Maybe that's where you've been. But maybe you're like my neighbor's spotlight. I'd like to be like that. Maybe not to the point of being quite so obnoxious to some people, but we want to be seen. We need to be noticed. If I will let him, God will fan the fires of faith within me and within you to where they lick up high like a bonfire. Where people notice how we live and are drawn to it like moths to a flame. That's what I want to be. That's how I want my life to be. Again, it's a daily battle. Not a battle to find enough Jesus to shine, but to find enough ways to put myself in the background so that I'm out of the way. I don't know where you are tonight, but I think that's a good place for a challenge for us. So what's response look like to a short, hard, and fast message like this? Well, I think what it looks like for us is that we have to decide just how bright we want to be. Are we going to give in to pressure from our coworkers to keep our mouth shut, or family members? Are we going to let the government tell us about our faith and what we can and can't believe? Are we going to get over our fear and share the gospel with that person that we know is hurting and needs to know so badly? And are we willing to make the hard calls at work for integrity? I've been there. I've been in sales in the past, and that tested my faith more than anything. Because sometimes the chips were down. Sometimes I needed one more sale. And the temptation was great. And some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And sometimes we blow it, and sometimes we do well. So what are you going to be? What kind of light? I think as we move into a time of response, Terry and Rick, if y'all want to come, I'm going to hand this back over to Terry as we move into that. But I think I just call us to a challenge tonight. And in just a minute, after we've done some time of prayer and response, I'll tell you how that applies to a school and how a school impacts a community. What do you want to be? How bright do you want to be? Or maybe do you just need to let God help you get the bowl off of your head so you can shine? I think that's a big part for some of us. So I'm going to hand it to these guys as we pray. And you do whatever business with God that you need to do tonight. Father, thank you for time together. And I know we're pausing in the middle and we're segmented with what we're doing tonight. But I know that you speak. I know that you touch lives and hearts. And I know that as you challenge me with this, you're challenging others as well. Give us courage enough to ask you to make a change. Give us courage enough to let our true lives be seen and not consider faith to be a private matter, but to be a matter that we have to share with people around us. Encourage us, challenge us, inspire us. Build us up and free us from the things that limit us. In Jesus' name, amen.